I'm happy to introduce our final keynote presenter, Dr. James Pauley. Dr. Pauley is an associate professor of theology at Franciscan University in Steubenville, a position he's held actually since 2002, and he is a graduate of Steubenville as well, so it's a return home for him. He earned his doctorate in sacred theology from the Liturgical Institute at the University of St. Mary of the Lake Mundelein Seminary on the topic of liturgical catechesis. He's the editor of the Catechetical Review, and he provided all of you with a copy of that, Franciscan's journal dedicated to the new evangelization. I'm an academic, and I understand academics who, like, academics kind of want to think pastorally, and, like, they want to form pastoral ministers, but they don't always know how, because they weren't pastoral ministers themselves. Dr. Pauley, though, has worked for years in parish catechetical ministry before he went to pursue his doctorate. This is the work he knows and does well on the ground. Today, he will speak on what was the topic, ultimately, of his dissertation, and will be a book through Hillenbrand Books, through Liturgy Training Publications, Liturgical Catechesis, An Apprenticeship in Mystery and Mission. So let's welcome Dr. Pauley.
Good afternoon. We've made it to the final keynote session, at least, without a huge major storm blowing through. I laugh because the last time I was at this university was about 2.5 years ago, and as I drove in, there had been a huge windstorm. And we actually drove by a house that had a tree that fell on top of it. And so as I'm driving in just a couple days ago, there is a huge storm. And before the end of the last session, Tim says, at 2 o'clock, we're supposed to get another big, which is exactly, see, it's me. I want to thank Tim for the invitation to be here with you. I want to thank all of you for whatever sacrifices you undertook to be here at this wonderful symposium. It's been a joy to be here. It's been a joy to have so many great conversations with people. Just a couple introductory words. I'm married. I have 3 little girls, a 10-year-old, and twin 8-year-olds. And it's particularly exciting right now because I have a dear friend who recently told me that after the age of 10, it gets a lot easier raising girls. And we're almost there with our 8-year-olds. I've lost all credibility already. My interest in liturgical catechesis was actually triggered by one of my twin daughters when I was working on narrowing a topic for my dissertation. We went to a baptism at a church in Chicago for some dear friends. And as the priest asked that beautiful question, "Do you believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth?" one of the twins, who will remain nameless, at the top of her 1.5-year-old lungs yelled, "No!" And she continued to yell, "No, no, no, no," as I had her over my shoulder sprinting for the back door. And as I got her outside, I looked at her and said, "You need liturgical catechesis." But I was thinking about that. See, this is a great fable within our family now. We love to tell that story. I was thinking about it the other day and realizing she may have actually not been rejecting God. I'm joking. Of course she wasn't rejecting God. She may have actually been having a flashback because about 6 months earlier, she was a little over 1, she and her twin sister. And my wife received a phone call from a dear friend inviting her to go on an Ignatian retreat for a weekend, not the 8-day retreat, but for a weekend. And my wife immediately said, "Oh no, I can't do that." And I sat down with her and said, "Honey, you could do that. Of course you could do that." And she said, "Well, who's going to take care of the twins in the middle of the night? She's nursing. And I said, well, I will. I'll take care of them. We're good. Go, go. You have to go on this retreat. See, I'm a superhero. I don't know if you knew that or not. She continued to think about it, and she said, well, what about Mass? There's no way you could take all three of them by yourself without my help to Mass. And I said, of course, just try me. I was born for this. So she left on a retreat, and I took them to Mass in a double stroller, and I was so confident that Daddy was going to take care of this that we went halfway down and found a seat. And we were doing great. I was passing missalettes to each of them, and they were paging through and just as happy as could be. We found a hymnal, and they were opening it up and playing with toys, and we were doing just wonderfully until the rite of sprinkling. When our pastor was coming through, and he thought it was so cute, these two little twin girls in their thing, and so he gave them a personal sprinkling. And that was it. I was sprinting for the door with the double stroller. So I think she was maybe having a little bit of a flashback. We've heard numerous references to catechesis over the course of these keynote presentations. We've heard numerous references to catechesis being in decline, catechesis struggling, catechesis being a failure. And I want to say during this presentation, I think that we would all agree that liturgical catechesis, and by that I mean the catechesis that prepares people for a sacrament, and then also post-sacramental catechesis, which might come afterwards, that liturgical catechesis is in need of renewal today. I'm hearing this frequently in the presentations, from the first one to the last ones. So I would like to propose a different approach when it comes to liturgical catechesis, a way forward that I believe has significant potential. First of all, just by show of hands again, how many of you are involved in catechetical ministry in your parish? Okay, all right, a good number. How many of you are involved with children? Teenagers? Okay, adults? Adults in RCIA? Okay, all right, so we have a really fantastic mix of people here. Well, it's my hope that this presentation and the discussions afterwards serves you in the need that that you come here with. We've been discussing various cultural shifts and demographic shifts here in the United States. And these shifts, not only do they challenge us liturgically, but they also challenge how we communicate the content of the faith today. What worked 10 years ago, what worked 5 years ago might not work as well today. And so there is this need for a continuing reflection upon what we're doing and how we're doing it. I'd like to begin by reading just a little excerpt out of this book. Let's see if I can make this work right. Becoming a Parish of Intentional Disciples. How many of you have read Sherry Waddell's Forming Intentional Disciples? Okay, all right, a good number of you. This is the follow-on book where she asked a number of parish leaders to write chapters. And I'd like to read to you just a little excerpt out of a chapter entitled Rethinking Youth Ministry by Jim Beckman. I was at the Saturday evening session of a teen retreat that we had spent months planning. This was the typical powerhouse moment of the weekend, and I expected teens to experience similar breakthroughs as I had seen in previous years. But as I watched the young people around me, I could tell that something was not connecting. And if I was really honest with myself, I had seen this coming for a number of years. Our weekly youth group nights, our semester retreats, the constant activity of the youth ministry machine, it just didn't seem to be hitting on all cylinders as it had before. That Saturday night, I watched as volunteer team members poured themselves out with great creativity. But the crowd of teenagers seemed distant, as if they were watching something on TV, had grown tired of it, and were ready to change the channel. What had we done wrong? Had we not planned enough? Were the skits not relevant? Maybe we picked the wrong speaker. A flood of questions ran through my head as the teens went off to recreation time. Why was it so hard to get to the hearts of these kids? Deep down, I knew something bigger and more serious was going on. I have talked with many youth ministers, one after another, who feel that the ministry that they are doing is waning in its effectiveness. They struggle to connect with teenagers. The teens seem to respond differently than they expect. And their ministry seems to lack staying power in the teens' lives. Many teenagers are unplugging from ministry well before their junior or senior year of high school. Does this resonate at all with those of you who are working with teenagers? Okay, so Jim Beckman's proposal in that chapter, I think, is a fairly radical one for many youth ministers. He suggests a transition away from large group youth ministry, which typically might break into smaller groups at some point during the session. And Jim is proposing the reverse, a small group approach to youth ministry that periodically will gather the small groups into a larger group. And he proposes this to allow for the opportunity of mentoring. His proposal is that each of these small groups needs to have two well-formed adult leaders who know and love the Lord and have a zeal for these young people so that they are able to more personally engage them rather than what was going on in the larger group. Now, mentoring is not a new concept. It actually goes way back to the divine teacher who mentored the 12 and sent them out. We're not going to trace this concept back quite that far. I would like to just point out to you that the Second Vatican Council had a very significant statement when it comes to this idea with catechesis. And this is on your handout. This is from Ad Gentes. Speaking about the role of apprenticeship within the newly restored catechumenate. I quote Article 14, "The catechumenate is not a mere expounding of doctrines and precepts, but a training period in the whole Christian life, and an apprenticeship duty drawn out, during which disciples are joined to Christ their teacher." This presentation will be exploring this concept of apprenticeship and what it might mean for liturgical catechesis. My family recently had an amazing experience. Our little twin daughters made their first Holy Communions just a couple months ago. And we had a dear friend of ours make a beautiful offer to our family. She lives in Arizona. She is an artist and an iconographer. And she offered to come to Ohio and spend 4 days with our family teaching us how to write an icon. And she made this offer to serve as a commemoration of this first Holy Communion. I had sent an email plea out to dear friends that I had great respect for, saying, I want to find a gift that would really be wonderful for them to commemorate this event, and I don't know what to get them. And her offer was, how about I come out, and we spend time, and they'll remember the experience along with their first communions. So Celine came out and spent 4 days with us, helping our family to write icons. So we have, she's teaching them up in the corner. These three images here are the fruit of 4 days of icon writing apprenticeship. And the one on the right is the one that Celine did. And so we were really learning quite a bit from her. This was an exquisite experience for my family. Do you want to see mine? I want to show you my icon. Aren't I good? That's just what we need, an arrogant iconographer standing up here teaching. I say that as a joke, because in reality, I worked on this for day one, and then I had to go back to work. And so Celine finished what I started. So we entered into, in a very profound way, an apprenticeship as a family, and it was beautiful. I'd like to suggest three different characteristics of apprenticeship, of the apprenticing relationship. There's no question in my mind that we could add to this, but these are the three that really recommended themselves from this experience that we just had. First of all, and this is on your handout, first of all, when we are being apprenticed, we are putting ourselves under the direction of someone who has mastered or is mastering a craft. And this is precisely what we did as a family with Celine. Secondly, the objective of this experience of apprenticeship is to learn a new way of seeing and a new way of living. Right? We learn how to see differently, and there are certain abilities that we learn in this process. When I think of my personal experience, that one day that I spent doing this, it was quite profound. How did I learn how to see in a different way? Well, I realized just how locked into efficiency I am, or I strive to be. Because there's always lots of balls up in the air for all of us, right? And so when Celine told us that that the way that an icon has that quality of glowing, the way that that happens is the paint which is used is thinned out with water, significantly so. And so there's coat after coat after coat after coat of paint on there. And so she, I put some paint in my little cup, and she said, you have to add a lot more water to that. And so I added water, and she said, oh no, a lot more than that. And I took my paintbrush, and I dipped it in, and I stroked some paint on, and I really couldn't see much at all. And that frustrated me, because I thought I was going to be done fairly quickly. But it took a long time to paint these strokes. And what I found happening in me was, this was a process of slowing down. And at first I wasn't comfortable with that at all, but it was a slowing down process. And as I continued to paint, it became a meditation. It became very beautifully prayerful to do the same thing again and again and again, painting the Madonna and Child. Painting, writing the Madonna and Child. So in apprenticeship, this is what we learn. We see in a new way, and we learn new abilities as well. Thirdly, a third quality to this relationship is that this learning happens through a sustained presence with the one who is doing the apprenticing. There's time in this relationship for questions, for a responsiveness, for a genuine conversation to develop. And there's certainly a significant investment on the part of the one who is teaching as an apprentice. And boy, did this get driven home to me the last night. So Celine spent 4 long days with my family. At the end of it, I thought that this icon looked beautiful. It was time for bed. It was about 11 o'clock, and she was still working on it. I had told her that it was my parents' 50th wedding anniversary this July, and that I decided after I saw what she did to my icon that we were going to give this to her as a family for their anniversary. And so it was 11:30. She had an early morning flight. We all went to bed. I woke up at 4:30 in the morning to come out and get some water, and Celine was still there, continuing to paint this icon, pouring herself out in this marvelous, humbling way. That felt sacred to me, to be loved sacrificially in that way. And that's precisely what happens in this apprenticeship relationship. There is a giving of self, and there is an investment of time. Okay, let me land the plane. The hope of the Second Vatican Council was that RCIA would be an environment that reflects a deeply personal formation, right? When the council document calls for the catechumenate to be an apprenticeship, this is exactly what the council was hoping for. Now, one of the most fascinating statements in the 1997 General Directory for Catechesis can be found in Article Number 90, where that document says that the catechumenate is the model, the inspiration for all catechetical activity. Is that a familiar idea to some of you who are in catechetical work? When this document came out in the late 90s, there was lots of discussion about this idea and what it might mean. And it means many different things. But certainly one of the things that it means is that this practice of apprenticeship is being recommended more broadly within the catechetical setting. Now, very, very briefly, there have been some related insights proposed in recent years. First of all, I would point to our beloved Holy Father, Pope Francis, in Evangelii Gaudium 169 to 170, but really, he talks about this all the time. Our Holy Father describes evangelization as a spiritual accompaniment. You've heard him use the accompaniment language. In Evangelii Gaudium, he speaks of this accompaniment as teaching us to remove our sandals before the sacred ground of the other person. And so Pope Francis envisions evangelization as a process that happens best person to person, and within the context of respect and love. Another insight could be found in Article 47 of the General Directory for Catechesis, which describes slow stages of evangelization. The fourth stage, jumping right ahead, is the catechumenate, and that's the specifically catechetical part of the evangelization process. But that's preceded by a third point, which is the proclamation of the gospel and the call to conversion, which is the announcement of the kerygma. Tim O'Malley just recently wrote an article for NCCL where he said exactly this, that catechesis ought to be preceded by an announcement, a delivery of the kerygma. But before that third stage, there's a second. And the second one, and I love how this is phrased, is titled Dialogue and Presence in Charity. And so before the kerygma can be proposed, before relationship with God can be proposed, there needs to be a conversation. There needs to be a relationship, a friendship that is established. And it's within that context that a person might be more likely to receive what it is that we want to offer. A third and final related insight is very simply Sherry Waddell's emphasis on thresholds of conversion. If you've read Forming Intentional Disciples, then you're very familiar with that idea, because that's really at the heart of her book. She describes 5 different thresholds on the way to intentional discipleship, which is the 5th. Initial trust, curiosity, openness, seeking, and intentional discipleship. And with each threshold comes different needs, and a person in one threshold and another person in another threshold need to be approached differently. Now, we all obviously have different temperaments and personalities, and it benefits us to be approached differently. I think of my twins, again, and their first confessions. That was another marvelous day just a couple months ago. Marin jumped up, and she wanted to go to the priest who was sitting up on the altar face to face. And Monica very quietly shuffled in line to go into the confessional and make her first confession behind the screen. Marin comes back just bouncing up and down. She has so much joy in her about what she just experienced. And she sits down and she says, "Can we go tomorrow too?" I was completely taken aback. Monica comes back and her legs are shaking. This was such a challenging experience for her. And so here we have these two human beings growing up in the same family. They're exactly the same age, almost. And we have these two very, very different reactions. So I think there's real insight here with what Sherry Waddell is saying, that that we need to study the person, be aware of the needs of the person. Where is this person on the road of conversion? And what we say, what we do, ought to be tailored to where they are. Okay, so we have these 3 different concepts fairly recently proposed that I think are very similar to apprenticeship. And I think there's much that we could glean from this. So if this model of apprenticeship were to inspire our catechetical approaches, I think we could make a couple observations, and these are on your handout. I'm a good catechetics person. I have a handout for you. First of all, the content of the faith would, of course, be communicated within the catechetical setting, but it would be done so in a more personal way, in such a way that it can be received by the person, taken in, taken to heart, so that there would be the possibility of a real response of faith. Secondly, and by the way, that would require a real skill set on the part of the catechist teacher. Secondly, all that is taught would be oriented to how it might be lived, right? We were hearing earlier this morning about the importance of experience. Absolutely. Within catechesis, this is the primary objective, is the integration of faith and life. This has to happen catechetically. Within an apprenticeship model, the one who is teaching is a witness who is able to speak from her own experience, from his own experience, about what this integration looks like. And number 3, an apprenticeship approach to catechesis would allow time for a responsiveness, for those who are being apprenticed to respond, right? Ultimately, we hope, with a response of faith. But there would be time allowed for a dialogue, for mentoring to take place. I'll tell you, one reason why I esteem many of the ideas of Sophia Cavalletti is that she very beautifully employs the Montessori principles of allowing time for silence within the catechetical setting. allowing time for a child to meditate in a suitably childlike way, allowing time for God to move, and allowing time for there to be informal guidance and conversations between the catechist and the child within the catechetical setting. That's one reason why I esteem many of her ideas. Fourthly, a fourth quality to a catechesis that would be an apprenticeship is that we would be learning a new way of seeing and a new way of living. We would not be receiving doctrinal content in a way that's disembodied from discipleship, in a way that's disembodied from culture, disembodied from life. That would be a significant part of what apprenticeship would mean. So my proposal for us today, as we're thinking about liturgy, as we're thinking about catechesis, is that the apprenticeship model is the most germane to liturgical catechesis. Because, in the words of one of my favorite Second Vatican Council theologians, the liturgy is the place of divine encounter par excellence. Cipriano Vagagini was fond of writing. Because the liturgy is this place of encounter with God, the apprenticeship model, I want to argue, is most germane when we are doing liturgical catechesis. It was the insight of the church in the early centuries that apprenticeship was needed as catechumens approached God in the sacraments. Liturgy is where the paschal mystery is made accessible to us. And therefore, because that's the case, we need to have a new way of seeing. We need to be able to, see the mystery within the context of the sacrament, within the context of the liturgy. And we need to learn a new way of living, a way that is in continuity with the gift that we have received. In short, what is needed in liturgical catechesis is a conversion in how we see, and a conversion in how we live as a result of that sacrament. And so my argument is that this conversion is best experienced person to person, with a catechist who is a witness, a guide, who can speak from his or her own experience about what is happening within the sacramental act. I want to just give a very brief example here from the Catechism. This is article number 1624 in the Catechism. And this is about the sacrament of marriage, what is received, what is different in the sacrament of marriage. Catechism, why don't you go ahead and give it a read for a second? What we have here is a statement of the objective fruits, some of the objective fruits of the sacrament of marriage. And these are significant. There's something new here within the relationship that wasn't there before. Whereas before, the source of the couple's love and the strength to renew their fidelity came out of their own natural capacities, with the grace of this sacrament, they're no longer drawing merely on their own natural capacities. Who becomes the source of their love? Who becomes the strength to renew their fidelity? So there's a significant statement here about objectively what the sacrament confers. Now, it's obviously necessary for us as subjects to see and to cooperate with this gift if it's going to make any real difference in the relationship, for example, that I have with my wife. Okay, so I'd like to suggest, I think this is a good example, I'd like to suggest that merely teaching about the sacraments, merely communicating content from a textbook, let's say, without accompanying and mentoring our catechetical participants in what this means for how we live, it's not enough. And so, I'd like to give just a couple of very concrete examples of what this could look like. I want to attempt to answer the question, and I think this is what from a catechetical perspective, what we ought to be asking ourselves: what abilities are needed in order for full, conscious, active participation to be possible for people today? What is it that, as we enter into the liturgy, what do we need to know how to do? How do we need to be able to see as we enter into this experience? That's important, isn't it? Because where do we learn full, conscious, active participation? Where does that happen? We could learn it in the liturgy itself, but not if we're already tuned out. It's going to be very difficult for that to happen. Ideally, we're going to be learning it from our parents. We're going to learn it in the context of our home, where it's being modeled and apprenticed. But as you know and as I know, it can be difficult sometimes to find parents who are doing this themselves, who are able to model and teach their children. So where is it that we learn these skills and abilities? Oftentimes it falls on the shoulders of the catechist to teach this. But if the catechist is merely teaching in a theoretical way about the liturgy, about the Mass, about the sacraments, and there isn't that attempt to apprentice and make connections in a more personal way, I'm not sure where it's going to be learned. So, I'd like to suggest that these are abilities that can be learned within the catechetical setting, very concretely. Number one, a first necessary ability, is the ability to disengage from distractions and attune ourselves to God within the sacramental action. My argument is that that is a necessary ability for full conscious active participation, is that we have to be able to push aside what preoccupies and be able to give ourselves, focus ourselves on how God is present. And keep in mind the Council's teachings on the various ways that Christ is present within the sacraments. To help us envision the need for this, I want to just make a quick confession. A number of years ago, I went to an evening Mass, and it was one of those evenings where my mind was elsewhere, and I was going through the motions. After Mass, with some friends, we went to go see a movie, and I'm halfway down the movie theater where we find our aisle, and I'm down in a genuflection in the movie theater before I jump back horrified. Right, and I realized right then and there where I had been all night long, just hollowly, ritualistically speaking, singing, doing, without really giving myself to those actions. So there are two movements needed as we enter into liturgical prayer. The first is, and I'm thinking of Daniela's presentation yesterday, which was so beautiful. The first is we have to be able to move past that continuous, partial attention that we give. And secondly, we have to consciously, actively put ourselves in the presence of God. And when we do those two things, real liturgical transformation becomes more possible, if we are present to God who is present to us and present to one another as well. So how can catechists mentor others in this ability? I would say by being particularly attentive to how we spend the first 5 to 10 minutes in the catechetical setting. because those exact two abilities are needed there as well. Is God present in the catechetical setting? With all my heart, I say yes, he is. And therefore, if we are preoccupied thinking about other things as we come into our RCIA session, it's very difficult to miss how God is present. And so I would suggest within the first 5 to 10 minutes, this is an opportunity to help disengage them. And if we do that, if we're able to get their attention and enter into a place of genuine prayer during that time, then anything becomes possible catechetically. A second necessary skill that the catechist can teach is the ability to see and receive and give in a sacramental way. I believe that the liturgy presupposes this of us. It has to be learned outside of the liturgical context, and we bring it with us when we enter into liturgy. For many people, the sacramental way is a stumbling block. A misunderstanding here gives rise to questions such as, why do I have to go to a priest to have my sins forgiven? It's not seeing in a sacramental way. How can bread and wine be the body and blood of Christ? How can these words, which look like human words, how can they really be the word of God? How can the pouring of water in baptism result in all that the church says that it does? These are sacramental questions and issues. And the answer to these questions lies in understanding sacramental language as a way that God has chosen to communicate himself to us. God has chosen to make himself accessible to human beings by way of words and actions that are drawn from our common human experience. And so, what's necessary is we need to be able to see in a sacramental way. And we can help our students to understand that what we perceive by the senses indicates what is happening on the spiritual, supernatural level. And so if we were standing in the balcony 15, 20 minutes before Mass begins and we see our lovely parishioners streaming into the church, what we're seeing visibly is a sign. It's an indication of what is also happening on the invisible supernatural level. Correct? By seeing human beings coming in, we're reminded that there is another gathering that is taking place here. We're not alone, even if it's one or two of us. We need this sacramental way of seeing in order to understand that as the water is poured over the head of a person being baptized, there is a deeper cleansing which is taking place here. There is a dying. There is a new life. There is a restoration that is happening through these waters. We need to be able to see in this way to understand that when a white garment is put on a newly baptized person, it's a sign of this person's interior newness. This is the underpinning logic to the whole of the sacramental life. Without this way of seeing, it's very difficult for us to truly unite ourselves to the prayer of liturgy. Very difficult if we don't understand that about the words, the signs, the symbols, the gestures. Big question is this. Is this too theological for people today? Too difficult to teach this sacramental way of seeing? Well, I don't think so. And let me give you some wisdom from another catechist who also doesn't think so. This is my second quote of Sophia Cavalletti. I love lots of other thinkers, by the way, but she's fitting very nicely into this presentation. Sophia writes this. So again, is this too difficult for people? Listen to what she says. It is a fact that the child seems capable of seeing the invisible almost as if it were more tangible and real than the immediate reality. Children penetrate effortlessly beyond the veil of signs, and they see with utmost facility their transcendent meaning, as if there were no barrier between the visible and the invisible. For those of you who work with children, does this resonate with your experience with children? She gives two little examples of what this concretely looks like in her own atrium. So Sophia's Italian, these are Italian names. Bianca, who's 5.5 years old, was mixing flour with yeast as an exercise related to the parable that compares the kingdom of God to the yeast that leavens the dough. The catechist asked her to explain to a woman who had come to visit the center what she was doing. Bianca responded, "I am watching how the kingdom of God grows." A group of children between the ages of 6 and 7 were meditating together with the catechist on baptism as the participation in the life of the risen Christ. All the children were holding little candles in their hands that had been lit from the Paschal candle. The catechist wanted to help the children's meditation and spoke about the beauty of that candlelight that they had received, but Agnes constantly corrected her, saying, "It isn't light, it's goodness," as if the goodness were more visible to her than the light itself. Isn't that fascinating? I don't know. Perhaps this is one reason why the Lord said we all need to become like little children, to be able to see in this way. A third skill when it comes to being apprenticed into the mystery. And again, these are skills that I would argue the catechist can teach. Must teach. Because I'm not sure who else would be teaching them if their parents aren't teaching them. Number 3, the ability to unite mind and heart to the language of liturgy. Before the Second Vatican Council, there were 60 to 70 years of liturgical renewal taking place. The council, of course, was the fruit of that liturgical movement. And one of the battle cries during those decades of rediscovery was this. They would say, "Don't pray at Mass, but pray the Mass. Don't pray at Mass, but pray the Mass." Why would they say such a thing? What were people doing during Mass? All right. So the Mass before the council, and again, this is maybe too much of an overgeneralization to say, but was frequently understood to be the prayer of the priest, and particularly if people didn't understand the Latin, then they would be praying their own private devotional prayers in their own best way to unite themselves with what the priest was doing up around the altar. Well, the reformers were asking to help the faithful to be able to enter into the prayer of the church, which is the liturgy. So, what can catechists do to help people pray the words of the Mass, pray the words of a sacramental celebration? I would argue that one of the best ways a catechist can do this is to draw upon the sacramental rites themselves, the language, the prayers, the words of the rites themselves, and teach people from those words in order to help them to understand what's going on in the sacraments. Now, of course, this has to be done very carefully Because if you were to stand in front of an average group of seventh graders and say, for the next 2 hours, I'm going to explain the words of the Mass, you would lose them immediately, right? But one who is apprenticing, who is a witness, who is able to speak with authenticity and with joy about what is happening in a particular sacrament, will do this in a lively and interesting way. And I would suggest not big chunks, but small parts to make connections for people, to make points for people. I think it's particularly important to do this in sacramental preparation. I'll make a second confession. When I first started working in a parish, I was 18 years old, fresh out of high school with absolutely no theological training whatsoever. But I was in a wonderful parish, and my pastor was very willing to mentor me. And there was a great parish staff there in place to help. But that being said, I made a lot of mistakes. And one of the mistakes that I made that I look back on now with some regret is how we approached the rite of confirmation with the 16-year-olds who were being confirmed at that time. This is a large parish. We would have between 100 and 120 16-year-olds being confirmed every year. And this is what the catechetical session before the rite looked like. We got everybody in alphabetical order in the parish hall, and we walked over to the church, and it took us a good 10 minutes to get everybody seated where they needed to be seated and sitting in their places, and then we practiced the rite, culminating in, they would form a procession, and yours truly would be during this mock confirmation. I would be the bishop, and I would make the sign of the cross over the forehead, and I would say, be sealed with the gift of the Holy Spirit, and they would respond, amen, and I would extend my hand, peace be with you. They would shake my hand and also with you, and then they would go sit down, and that was it. That's what we did to prepare them for the rite of confirmation. Now, I ask you, if there isn't anything additional that is a sustained, joyful reflection on what those words mean, on what those gestures mean, then it's highly unlikely that those who are being confirmed are going to be able to participate at the level that the council was wanting for us in these years since. For us, that confirmation was still a beautiful experience. It was a moving experience. Many people were brought to tears, and it was fantastic. But there is still something lacking if we don't see properly with the rite. So catechists who are involved in preparing people for the sacraments, there is a unique opportunity to look to the language of the rites as a source. Of course, we have to do that prudentially, and we have to do that with a real respect for their capacity. So I would say little bits at a time. But certainly this isn't limited to sacramental preparation. Any time that we're teaching about sin and grace, to be able to draw from the readings and the rich prayers of the Ash Wednesday liturgy, let's say, especially if this catechesis is happening in close proximity to Ash Wednesday, it's a beautiful thing, isn't it? To be able to teach about the mercy of God from the prayer of absolution, from the rite of reconciliation. See, if we do that, if we're thinking liturgically and bringing the rites into our teaching, there's a twofold benefit, of course. Number one, if they have heard those words before, then we're drawing on something that they already know. It's familiar to them, and it's going to be much more likely to stick for them. But then secondly, what's going to happen the next time they go to receive the sacrament of penance and reconciliation? They're hopefully going to remember what it is that you taught them. And that experience of hearing those words wash over them has greater potential to be transformative. Okay. And finally, the final skill that I think could be cultivated today is the ability to be responsive to the grace that God gives in the sacraments. Pope Francis, in September of... Okay, here we go. I missed these slides. In 2013, I had the great privilege of being in Rome for the International Congress on Catechesis. And this is what Pope Francis said: the more that you unite yourself to Christ and he becomes the center of your life, the more he leads you out of yourself, leads you from making yourself the center and opens yourself to others. Isn't that beautiful? So this is, he went on to talk about the heart of the catechist, having this systolic and diastolic movement of drawing close to Christ oneself and giving Christ to others. That this is what the catechist does, and both are very, very important. Whatever we experience, whatever we receive in the sacraments, has a radical effect, could have a radical effect on how we live and how we treat others. And that connection is necessary, but it doesn't happen automatically, as we know. And so this is where an apprenticeship can truly come in and be helpful. When it comes to mystagogical catechesis, I would suggest that there's two primary sources. First would be theological, in order to be able to communicate what objectively is being communicated and conveyed in the sacrament. But secondly, the second source would be authentic witnesses, people who are able to speak from their own experience about what they have received in the sacrament, how it has been transforming them. I think both of those elements would be necessary in any mystagogical approach to catechesis. Now, that's the proposal, an apprenticeship model for catechesis. There are clear challenges and obstacles in our way to doing this. Yes? We could probably make a list. And I'm going to name three of the challenges that would find their way onto that list. In 2013, the Institute for Church Life surveyed diocesan DREs. And those DREs, the survey found that the DREs believe that the greatest weakness in catechetical ministry today is the lack of trained and qualified personnel. Okay, that's going to prove a difficulty to this idea of more individual apprenticing. A second difficulty: this presumes that there are sufficient numbers of what Sherry Waddell calls intentional disciples, right? Because ideally we would want someone who has a strong relationship with the Lord, who has had experience in the Christian life, who would be able to personally mentor a person. So that could also be a challenge that we face. Number three, catechesis frequently takes place in the structure of larger groups with just a few catechists. So how could the few be able to mentor the larger group? There's no question that these are legitimate challenges and legitimate questions. I suppose my answer to that is for us to begin small. I don't have a specific program to recommend with this. I'm seeing many conversations, both magisterially and in various books that are being written these days, about how important discipling people in a more personal way is. And I want us to begin to envision what that might look like in catechesis. I think the only way we would move forward is very, very small. One catechetical group at a time is what this might realistically be. To conclude, I would like to point out just some natural opportunities that are already present for this kind of a mentoring approach to catechesis. Number one, it remains a deep conviction within our tradition that parents are the primary educators. Of course, there is no greater challenge and frustration for many pastors and parish catechetical leaders than this, right? We hear this frequently, but my goodness, is this a significant challenge. But I want to point out, and in the opening presentation in the evening a couple days ago, this is certainly what we heard. Parents are already apprenticing life for their children, right? We learn how to be human from those adults who are in this very significant role. We just need to help them to apprentice the sacramental life. That's the challenge. Chris and Justin's research was so encouraging to me. I mean, I was ready to jump out of my seat with some jubilation that first evening. Because they're showing to us statistically the highest success rates take place in homes where the faith is not only lived, but it is lived reflectively. This is what I heard them say in the presentation. And that reflection of why we live the Catholic faith, being able to hear that from our parents, is, in their study, the most influential way that they're going to be able to live as Christians in the world. So any investment that a parish makes in this relationship between parent and child has great potential. Anything that we can do to help parents experience conversion and be able to talk about it with their kids, this is gold. This is time well invested right there. There are many family-based models of catechesis that are beginning to make the rounds. And these, I think, have a real benefit of entrusting greater responsibility to parents to be able to learn how to have those conversations with their kids. Number two, and number one really begs a question that I think number two answers. The church envisions adult evangelization and catechesis as the axis around which revolves every other form of catechesis. Adult evangelization, adult catechesis. If a parish becomes a place where adult disciples are made, then many catechists, many mentors will also be made in that parish. This is going to be adult evangelization is going to be the source of our catechists, of those who would be able to apprentice others in the Christian life. And this is not an option. It's necessary. I don't see any other way around these issues that we're facing catechetically other than to pour our energies into the evangelization of our adults. My pastor went to a conference a year and a half ago called the Amazing Parish Conference. He came back very deeply inspired. He's formed a leadership team. He's processing out of Mass one day, and he comes right to me and my wife and says, "I need to talk to both of you after Mass." And I thought, oh my goodness, what did I do? He asked us and a number of other people to be on this team to evaluate the parish in order to come to some conclusions about how we can be more evangelistic as a parish. We just recently ran an alpha course at our parish, which my wife went to. I was home with the kids in the fall. We're gonna do alpha again, and I'm gonna go, and she'll take the kids. And the stories that my wife has to say about the conversion that happened through that course for the adults who were present, the 50 or 60, they are extraordinary. And one thing that I'm particularly impressed with that approach, is because it is video-based, it doesn't rely on teachers, evangelists being in the parish who would be able to take this responsibility on their shoulders and do the evangelizing. Those leaders are able to lead small group discussions, and at least in our parish, There are tremendous fruits happening right now. And I look at that and I believe that this is going to be the wellspring for a renewal in our parish. Whatever it is that we do for adult evangelization, and there are many different opportunities today to really engage that question. Number three, I think we can invest more deeply in the mentoring roles that are already very clearly defined in the church, such as the role of sponsor, the role of godparent within sacramental prep and mystagogy. So the question is, how do we equip people to do this well? How do we provide opportunities for real spiritual growth on the part of those who are sponsors and godparents? These are natural apprenticeship roles. Number four, the neophyte year. Within the wisdom of the church, there's been this understanding that the year after receiving a particular sacrament is a sensitive period where we're learning how to cooperate with the gift that God has given us in the sacrament. When I got married, one of the best presents that we received was a Protestant book called The Most Important Year in a Man's Life. Was the front cover, and then you turn it over and it says The Most Important Year in a Woman's Life. And it's all about the first year of marriage and how to establish good, healthy, loving patterns in all of the different realms of married life. And the argument of the book is if you establish these patterns in the first year, it will make a serious difference for the rest of your married life. That was one of the best gifts for us. And we read it very, very carefully, and it led to lots of discussions. To me, that was something of a mystagogical process, coming to really prepare for living the sacrament as well as we could. Number five, we have in our tradition the practice of spiritual direction. And many of us in this room have benefited from spiritual direction of one kind or another. Make no mistake about it, this is an apprenticeship, spiritual direction. And in my mind, it's a model that could possibly be expanded upon in different ways. I know of one Midwestern diocese that has an extensive spiritual mentorship program for lay people who are able to go and receive training in the spiritual life with the idea that they would be able to mentor others in the parish, which I think is a fantastic idea. Of course, this is number six, our catechetical sessions themselves are opportunities for this apprenticing. And so what can we catechists do to become, to take a bit more of a mentorship perspective, to be guides, to be witnesses, to be able to speak from our own experience of our relationship with God and what life in this community is truly about? How do we build in time for those conversations? I think that's another great opportunity. And finally, I think we could look to the saints, who are our spiritual mentors in many ways. And many of them apprenticed others in a particularly beautiful way. And we can learn from that. We can learn from someone like St. Francis de Sales, Introduction to the Devout Life. I want to leave you with this little image from St. Therese, who I have a great devotion to. St. Therese was asked to teach younger Carmelite sisters at one point, and this was anxiety-inducing for her. And this is what she wrote. I saw immediately that the task was beyond my strength. Have you ever felt like that? I felt like that today, standing here in front of you. I felt immediately that the task was beyond my strength. I threw myself into the arms of God as a little child. And hiding my face in his hair, I said, Lord, I am too little to nourish your children. If you wish to give through me what is suitable for each, then fill my hand, and without leaving your arms or turning my head, I will give your treasures to them. Isn't that a fascinating image? I mean, imagine this little girl jumping into the arms of Jesus, hiding her face in her hair, being so connected to him and that she's not even looking the other way. She's giving what Jesus has while she's connected to him. I think that's a wonderful image of half of the apprenticing relationship, that it's necessary for us to be drawing from a reservoir of our connection with the Lord. But then we have to turn to the other. And we can certainly look at great saints, such as St. John Bosco, one of my favorites, and his emphasis on having teachers in his oratories be like fathers and be present to the boys, not only to keep them from getting into trouble, but also in order to mentor them and to bring them along. So, in my opinion, there's a whole field of study that's opening up before us in the work of catechesis to re-envision a way of liturgical catechesis that deeply respects the mystery of God and deeply respects the mystery of the person. Thank you very much.